Well, advertising and marketing companies are constantly trying to sell new ways to sell their products, come up with new ways. From straight down the line advertising to, you know, the weird and the wacky.
Wacky. It was like a scene from a horror movie in New York last week when cafe goers thought they were witnessing paranormal activity. In a term nicknamed Prankvertising, it isn't the first advertising campaign to shock the public. Have a look.
It was the scene that had cafe goers running for the hills.
Oh my God!
That sucks. I'm sorry.
You just ruined all of my stuff.
Get some napkins, clean it up, it'll be fine.
Fine, there's coffee inside of my computer. You know what? Just get away from me. Just get away from me!
But what they didn't know is that they were witnessing an elaborate prank advertising the upcoming release of horror flick Carrie. With over 17 million YouTube hits in just a few weeks, it seems scare tactics worked. LG also used the fear factor to promote their new flat-screen TVs. The small budget campaign had 20 million YouTube hits and gave LG a market growth of 20%. In 2012, a Belgium TV network pranked a local shopping district, tempting passers-by to push a red button. When they did, they found themselves in the middle of a flash mob. The idea paid off, going down in history as the second most shared ad of all time, proving just how profitable prankvertising can be.
Oh, gee, they're good when they get it right. To talk more about prankvertising, we're joined by co-founder of ThinkMoto Advertising Agency, Michael Krivica, and marketing expert Matthew Bywater in LA. Good morning to you both. Michael, first up, you and your colleagues are behind the Carrie prank, which were you expecting such a wide reaction? It was incredible.
Well, it was a lot of fun to do, and it did very effective. I mean, this is the kind of thing that every movie studio dreams of. You know, we stage something that looks really real, and it's a video that is short, it's bite-sized, it's fun to watch, it's fun to share, and it doesn't look and it doesn't feel like an ad, and that's really important for the viewing experience, because let's say you're having a bad day at work and you can spare 2 minutes to watch something really, really fun and enjoyable, and in the end it turns out it's an ad, but it's not really in your face. It doesn't, you know, come on as an ad. You don't know what it is that you're watching until the very end. And the most important thing about it is that the connection to what it is we're promoting, in this case it's a horror movie, is that it's really clever. It's about the theme of the movie. It's about a girl having telekinetic power. So it was all in all just a really clever way to get a lot of people talking about it and generate millions of views on YouTube.
Great.
So just to be clear, were they real customers who were caught unawares, or were they extras?
Yeah, the extras were only in the coffee shop. They were with the people who were sitting. But the customers who we captured, their reactions, those were real reactions. They had no idea what they're about to see. So that's very important, that you know, you have no idea what you're about to witness. And that's the great thing about it, is that as a viewer, you look at it and you ask yourself, well, what would I do if I were there? You know, how would I react? And that's what makes this fun to watch. That's what makes it engaging. And that's what makes you share it with everybody you know.
Yeah, I know what I'd do. I'd film it and go viral.
No, we actually talked about that. We were surprised how many people actually hung around and watched, because I would have been out of
the door.
Yeah.
Matthew, in LA, what are the downsides to this? Because we have seen a couple of these not quite go to plan and get the traction they wanted.
Yeah, well, legal suits aside, I guess, is one issue to look at. But the huge downside is you've got to be really careful when creating a prank. Is what you're really essentially doing is fooling your customer. And you've got to be really careful there, because you don't want to make a fool of anybody, particularly somebody who's going to potentially spend money with you. Where these guys have done well with the Carrie prank is that using real people it makes it really authentic. So what we've seen, some of the other ones, some of the LG ones, for example, we found out later on that all those people involved were actors. And what's happened is it leaves a bad taste in your mouth, because you feel like you've been fooled. You've been actually had one put over you.
Okay, there's a clip of people in a job interview. I need to think the world was ending. I mean, it's being heavily criticised for being staged. There is a risk, isn't there, that you take?
Yeah, and that is a risk because it's come out once again, they're all actors involved, so we're seeing maybe some poor acting as well, but they're all actors, so it's nothing authentic about it. There's also rumours as well that that's actually not an LG screen, it's actually a green screen, which if that comes out to be true, all of a sudden then there's a bit of a sour taste in people's mouth. Mm. So, and it's very important for brands, they've got to be true, they've got to be honest, they've got to be authentic, and they've got to be congruent. And right. If that comes out that way, it's not good.
Okay, Michael, very quickly, do you think people in the street, the average Joe, are waking up to this sort of concept now?
People are more aware, obviously, and to Matthew's point, I'm not sure, you know, really how much it matters in the end when the video is done, if something was real or fake. If it looks real, you know, how much does that really matter, you know, if it's really convincing?
Okay.
That's just my thought on it.
All right, guys, we are right out of time. Good hit out. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Well done on the carry.
Thank you for having me.
We loved it.
Yeah.